Praise the Lord. That is the height of consecration. I say, yes, Lord. Whatever he says, whatever he says, whatever he demands, I understand, I don't understand, I say, yes, Lord. Or just, you can sit down like that, bow your head, and just say that, I say, yes, Lord. What's he asking from you? What's he demanding from you? No struggling. I say, yes, Lord. That's all we can say. That's all Jesus said. He said yes to the Father. That's all Abraham did. When God called him, I say, yes, Lord. That's all the consecration that Moses could render. I say, yes, Lord. That's all the commitment and submission that the bride makes to the bridegroom. I say, yes, Lord. That's all that is required of a church to Christ. I say, yes, Lord. I lay my life on the altar. Then the revelations will begin to flow. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless your name. Thank you for this solemn assembly. Thank you for sending your ministers to us from various directions, using all means to remind us that you are Lord and you have the divine ownership of all we are and all will ever be. And Lord, with all humility, without withdrawing anything from the altar, we say, yes, Lord. Accept a sacrifice in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray, as we surrender and submit to you, we pray that you reveal yourself to us more and more in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, we pray. And the people of God said, I thought about what the Lord is revealing to us now, talking about revelation. And then I thought, what a time to talk about revelation when the people are almost going to sleep on me. When, you know, you've been here from morning and some of you before six, you are there digging deep and praying and bombarding heaven. And then we came, you know, another message, and different kinds of preachers. And they challenged us and they say, here is what you do. And now, when everybody gets tired, and I'm now about to have another session again, and I'm saying, how did they plan a program like this? And they always give me the tip, anyone, the people are going to sleep. And then I found the scripture. Can I tell you? I said, can I show you that God gives revelation when it appears you are tired? It appears you like to go and sleep. It appears to just think, there is nothing else for me to do. Let me lay my head somewhere and just switch off. And it is at that time that God brings a revelation. Looking at Genesis, and I'm reading from chapter 15. Genesis chapter 15. And you'll see here the great revelation that came. If you're going to have a revelation in your life, and the fulfillment of what God himself is saying, this is why I called you from your place, from where you're coming from. And this is what I want to accomplish. It is at that time when it appears you are tired, there's fatigue, there's tiredness, and it appears, allow me to just lay my head somewhere and sleep. And then revelation comes. It will come to you now in Jesus' name. Look at this in Genesis chapter 15. And I'm reading there from verse 9. And he said unto him, take me an heifer of 3 years old, and a she-goat of 3 years old, and a ram of 3 years old, and turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And he took unto him all these, and divided them in the midst, and laid each piece one against another. But the birds he divided not. And when the fowls came down upon the carcasses, Abram drove them away. The challenge will be there. Everything we have laid upon the altar, everything we said, oh Lord, this is yours. It may not just be at this Congress. Since you came to know the Lord Jesus Christ has been talking to you, I need this in your life. I need this in your life. I need this in your life. And you're able to surrender everything. At the time that revelation is about to come, the birds of the air, the fowls will come. They want to take away what you have laid upon the altar. And at this time, when it appears, you know, I'm tired, I'm weak, and physically I'm fatigued, I don't know what I'm going to do, it's at that time the fowl is coming and is going to take something away. And then I'm saying, I'm not as strong, as vibrant, as energetic, as vigorous as I was when I laid them on the altar. And at this time, if I allow the fowls, they'll take everything away, and then the sacrifice will be of no value. And then we're told in verse 12, and when the sun, of course Abraham drove them away, but now in verse 12, it says, when the sun was going down. And what's next here? Tell me out loud. Tell me again. A deep sleep fell on Abraham. Can you think about that? He has made the sacrifice already. God has not spoken. He has driven all the fowls away from the sacrifice. Revelation has not come. And then a deep sleep came upon Abraham. And then we're told in verse 12 here, and lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto him, Abraham. It was at that time when the great horror came upon him. It's like, what am I doing? Surrendering everything to the Lord? Am I going to go this far? Am I going to do this? And then I'm even tired. And look at my age. I'm already past the age of usefulness and productivity. And the horror came upon him as he thought about the time of his life and the age in which he was, and the demand that God was making, as if at this old age, start again. At this old age, begin right now. And this is what I'm calling upon you to do. When he thought about it, he was horrified. And a horror came upon him. And then he said, Lord, could you find a younger person to do this? And then it was this, at this time of tiredness and sleep, that God said, no, of a surety, that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward they shall come out. They shall come out. We're coming out. And when they come out, they'll come out with great substance, and thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace. Your life will be a peaceful life. Thou shalt be buried in a good old age. But in the fourth generation, see, all this revelation did not come when Abraham was still young, when Abraham laid everything upon the altar, and then before the horror came upon, the fear that came upon him, and the kind of thought that came into him, that he was literally horrified. And then the sleep, tiredness overtook his life. And then it was at that time of tiredness, at that time of weariness, at that time of weakness, that this revelation came unto him. I'm saying that, you know, so you don't know how God works. At the time you are tired, release us and let us go. The time is gone already. In fact, if you call all the scriptures, Pastor, even though I cannot talk to you now, but I can talk to you in my mind, to even open the Bible, my hand is weak to quote the Bible. Come on now, rise up, and I don't need you to stand up. Rise up in your heart and say, I'm a soldier of the cross, and I'm going to receive all the revelation God has for me in Jesus' name. You see, God works in a way that is different from the way you can be thinking. And it's at this time the Lord said in the fourth generation, in verse 16, they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between the pieces. that it was after he got tired that even the smoke came and the fire came to consume the sacrifice. The point I'm making to you is, don't just switch off and say, I don't think I can take any other thing again, because this is the best thing you've been waiting for. It will come upon your life in Jesus' name. I'm talking about revelation, the revelation of God's purpose for the church. The revelation of God's purpose for the church. We're coming back to this verse, you know very well now. Matthew chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 16, we're looking at verse 18. It says, and I say also to thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. What's the purpose of God in raising up the church? He wants to show to men and angels. He wants to show to heaven and earth. He wants to show to demons and evil spirits that he has the power to make man so converted. He makes to make man so courageous, to make man so solid, that even the very gates of hell rising against that people he will raise up, they will not be able to prevail against the church. Because you know, before this time, the devil had thought that God's creation was weak. He said, I can prove it to you. He went to Adam and Eve and he said, I can prove that the creation of God was weak. And then he came along and he saw Abraham and Sarah, and then there was no child. I can prove to you the creation of God was weak. And he came unto the time of the kings. I can prove to you that the creation of God is weak. And then he came to the time of the prophets and Judah and Jerusalem and the whole tribe of Israel, and he said, see them, see what they have done. He took them to captivity in Babylon. I can prove to you that the creation of God is weak. And God said, I stop you right there. I'm going to build a group of people, a congregation of people, an assembly, and I'm going to use that assembly, that congregation, it is called church. Upon this rock I will build my church. And although it succeeded with Adam and Eve, as well there were this and that through all those generations, but the gates of hell will not prevail against this church. God is putting us on display. He's saying, I am doing something that hell, Satan, evil spirits, evil people will not be able to prevail against. And look at it, about 2,000 years ago the church began. And the persecution that came in the Acts of the Apostles, the church is still there. The persecution that came in all those territories and all those lands, and the church is still vibrant and strong, because Jesus said, here is my goal, here is my purpose. I'm building a church that the very gates of hell will not be able to prevail against, and we're part of that church, praise the Lord. The gates of hell will not prevail against this church in Jesus' name. You know, sometimes you have a little local church there, local church there, a little local church there, and then when you see this local church, and you see the thing, the barrage of persecution coming against that local church, you are afraid, and you say, will this one stand? The purpose of Christ in building the church is to show that all the weaknesses of human frailty of the years that have gone by before he came, that all those years they have come to an end, that now he is building a church that will be the strongest entity in the whole world, that no matter what comes against it, it will stand. And that local church where you are, it will stand in Jesus' name. That the very gates of hell, were they to shift their position and come out of where they were and come against the church where the church is, that church will keep on standing in Jesus' name. The purpose of Christ, the purpose of the Lord in raising up the church, the revelation of God's purpose for the church. In John chapter 3, John chapter 3, I'm reading there from verse 29. John chapter 3, verse 29. Here it says, in verse 29, he that has the bride is the bridegroom. He that has the bride is the bridegroom. Look at verse 30. It says, he must increase, but I must decrease. He that cometh from above is above all. Now John here tells us another side of the issue. That Jesus Christ, the very Son of God, God wanted to prepare a bride for him. And he looked at all the angels and he couldn't find the bride for his only begotten son. Just like when he created Adam, he looked at all the animal kingdom, all those creatures, he couldn't find a wife for Adam. And then he said, I'm going to make somebody a help, meet and fit and suitable for him. And he created Eve. In the same way, he was looking all through the courts of heaven. All those angels, Michael was there and Gabriel was there, all the other angels, the children and seraphim, and he wanted a bride, he wanted a wife for his only begotten son. He just said, I'm going to give this as a gift. He that findeth a wife findeth favor from the Lord. And then of all the angels he couldn't find. And then he said, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise up people there and I'm going to raise them up as a bride unto my only begotten son. The purpose of God in raising up the church is so that what he could not find among the angels, what he could not find in the courts of heaven, he now comes to earth and he said, that is where I'm going to raise up a wife, a bride for my only begotten son. I'm looking at Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, revelation of God's purpose for the church. In Ephesians chapter 1, I'm reading verses 22 and 23. And put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church. And then he says, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. The purpose of Christ, the purpose of the Lord in raising up the church. Look at Christ. He says, I'm Alpha and Omega. He says, I'm the beginning and the end. And all the goodness of God, all the treasure, all the mystery of the Godhead, they reside in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then Jesus just wanted to pour out. You know, a good man wants to do good. A righteous man wants to good works. And he wants to pour out all his gifts, his all in all his treasure, everything that is God. He wants to pour it on some people. And he says, Which are those people? Where are they? And then he says, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise up a church. And that church will be the body of Christ. And then the fullness of all the virtues, the fullness of all the treasures, the fullness of all the glories of heaven and earth, I'm going to pour it into that church. That is why he raised up the church. And he's telling us that now you are part of that church, I'm part of that church, and we are part of that church. And all the resources of heaven he wants to put upon our lives. And I'm praying for you that you will be in your place. I said you'll be in your place. God is going to demonstrate his power in your life. His resources is going to put upon you. And he's going to show you to the angels and show you to Satan and show you to the evil spirit and say, you thought this person cannot be this and that. See the specimen of the glory and the beauty of heaven and see what I can do because you are part of his body. That's why we're looking at today, tonight, the revelation of God's purpose. The revelation of God's purpose for the church. There are three things I'm going to look at. Number one, the divine purpose for the bride of Christ. The divine purpose for the bride of Christ. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. We are called the bride. The church is called the bride. And the very purpose of Christ in coming and laying down his life and shedding his blood and then leading us to form the church and plant the church and bring the people of God together is so that you will be part of that bride. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 2. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. There is Paul the apostle saying, sometimes when you see the passion of your preacher, when you see the desire of your preacher, when you see how the preacher is saying, hey, this is what to do, this is what to be, and then he's watching over us. If a fly passes by, he brushes it off. If any kind of thing that will soil your garment is passing by you, he'll be watching. You see, what kind of jealousy is godly jealousy? That's why Paul the apostle said, over the church, because the church is the bride and the wife of Christ, the bride of the Lamb. I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you a chaste virgin unto Christ. And that's the reason why God formed the church. He brought the church so that we'll be a chaste virgin unto the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's a bridegroom of all beauty, of all glory, of all honor, of all virtue, and he's a bridegroom of all riches, of all wealth. And because of his position, the kind of bride, the kind of wife that he will have, that will be presented unto him, will be such a chaste virgin that will not be compared with any other personality, any other group, any other society, any other club, any other assembly in the whole world, because he is the greatest. Therefore the bride will be the greatest. He is the number one. Therefore the bride, you will be the number one in all the societies and companies and society or whatever in association that's in the world, to be a chaste virgin unto Christ. In Colossians chapter 1 verse 28, Colossians chapter 1 verse 28, here is what it says. It says in verse 28, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present, that we may present, that we may present. Remember now, we are presenting the bride to the bridegroom. We are presenting the wife to the husband. And then, because we honor the husband, we exalt the husband, we know he has a name above every name. And because he's the greatest, he's greater than the angels. What kind of bride would he have? He's greater than Moses. What kind of bride would he have? He's greater than Aaron, the first high priest. What kind of bride would he have? He's greater than Solomon, wiser than Solomon. What kind of bride would he have? He's richer than Abraham. What kind of bride would he have? When you find somebody like that, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, the very glory and the express image of the Almighty God. And he's so beautiful, he's so great, he's so high, he's so wise, he's so rich, and he's from eternity to eternity. What kind of bride will he have? That's the purpose. God is raising up a church. I don't understand for the people, they say, you know, they think that the church will remain weak and the church will remain unholy, the church will remain unrighteous. They do not understand what the church is. The church is the bride of Christ. And the kind of bride that feeds that Christ is a holy, chaste, and pure, righteous, sanctified bride. That's why it says to present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians 5, I read from verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Jesus Christ said, the kind of bride I want, I'm going to give everything I've got, my power to purify them, my provision to sanctify them, everything I've got, I'm going to give so that this bride will be the best bride that any king ever had, that any master ever had, that any emperor ever had. And that's the reason why Jesus gave everything he's got. That's the purpose. And if you are called as a minister, if you are called as a leader, if you are called as an overseer, if you are called as a preacher, if you are called as an evangelist, if you are called as a person that will help in helping that church, that will help in preparing that church, that will help in making sure that that church feeds the Christ who is the bridegroom, then you know you have a great work to do. I pray that God will give you faith, he'll give you wisdom, he'll give you the ability to do it in Jesus' name. It says, as Christ loved the church and he gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it for the washing of water by the word. Why would he want the church to be sanctified? Because the church is his wife, is his bride, and he wants the church to be as pure as possible, as holy as possible. Somebody is saying, can't we be too holy? Can't we be too sanctified? Can't we be too righteous? Is it not possible that a person say, I'm holy, and you know, fortunately for him, he becomes so holy that, you know, it's not fit for the world? And you're asking me, can a wife be so beautiful, too beautiful for the husband? Can a wife be too clean and too prepared and too giving to the husband? Can we be too consecrated? Consecration. Are we not in the danger of being too much consecrated unto the Lord? I'm saying, can the wife have the danger of being too submissive to the husband and be too consecrated to the husband, or be too submissive and yielded unto the husband? The answer is no. The Lord is telling us, he wants the church to be a bride. and whatever level of purity we can attain, whatever level of sanctification we can attain, and whatever level of holiness we can attain, that is the will of God, because He wants to sanctify that church. He wants to cleanse that church. Then it says in verse 27 that He might present it to Himself. He's not presenting it to Himself. He wants to show, you know, you got married. After you got married, if you have daddy and mommy, you want to say, "Daddy, this is my wife." That's what Jesus wants to do, that He might present you to Himself. He wants to go to the Heavenly Father and He says, "Father, that's my bride. Holy Spirit, that's my bride." He wants to show the church to the angels in heaven, because the angels are waiting. What kind of bride will He have? What kind of wife will He have? And see how they exalt Christ and the honor Christ and they promote Christ. Christ is over there in the mind of all the angels, because He was before them. In fact, He was their creator, and they bent down to Him, they bowed and they worship Him. And then He is now coming. He's coming with a bride. What kind of bride do you think Christ will want to show to those angels? That this is my bride. A bride He'll be proud of. A bride He'll be happy to show the angels. He'll be happy to show the Father. He'll be happy to show the Holy Spirit. He'll be happy to show all generations of people that this is my bride. That's why it says that He might present it to Himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. You see here that we're talking about the bride of Christ. That's the purpose. And therefore, if you're a preacher in the church, you understand why you're preaching. You know that your preaching is to prepare a bride for the Lord Jesus Christ, is to prepare a wife for this great, the greatest of all lords, and the greatest of all kings, and the greatest of all masters. And you want a wife for that individual and for that Christ. That's the reason why we're doing what we're doing. And I pray that God will give us understanding in Jesus' name. Now, those of all, as we come, as come bride of Christ, let's look at Psalm 45. Psalm 45, I'm looking at it from verse 10. Verse 10 and verse 11. Psalm 45, we're looking at verse 10. Hearken, O daughter, consider and incline an ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house. And you know, we were raising a bride for the king. That's the reason why this person went as a messenger, just like Elisha went to seek a wife for Isaac, the son, the only begotten son, and the lovely son, the lovable son, and the loved son, beloved son of Abraham. And then as we're seeking, we're telling the person, now we're going to take you to Isaac. We're going to take you to this man. You know what you're going to do? You're going to leave your father's house. You're going to forget all your background, your father's house. And then you're going to follow the man. And then they called this lady. And he said, "Will you go with this man?" And she said, "I will go." And then they said, "Well, give us about, even if it's about 10 days before she goes, because you have just come." I said, "Don't delay me. Since the Lord has prospered me, and the angel came before me, and he planned everything, release her so she can go with me." And he said, "Okay, let's ask the lady." That's what he said. "Will you go with this man? Are you ready now? Or you also still linger around and still, you know, fellowship with us? We'll be together all day." He said, "No, I'm ready now. I'm ready to go." And that's what the Lord is saying. As we go out to call people, we're making them the bride of Christ, and we're asking them, "Are you ready to go? Are you ready to be the bride that will forget your father's house?" Look at it. But said again, "Hearken, O daughter, and consider and incline thine ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty." It says, when you forget your father's house, when you forget all your background, when you forget all the things you are holding on to before you knew that this Christ is going to be my husband, this Christ is going to be my bridegroom, when you forget all that, it says there's a beauty. That's a beauty. It's not just the facial appearance. It's not just the dressing. It's the very fact that you are totally attached and totally given and totally submissive and totally committed unto this bridegroom. And that is what the preachers are doing. That's why the preachers are going out and we're telling the people, Christ is the bridegroom and we are the bride. Come on, come and join and come get converted and then be totally committed and let Christ the bridegroom be the number number one in your life and forget your father's house and forget all your past, so that you'll be totally attached, totally in fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ, the bridegroom. Because it's only then, in verse 11, it will desire greatly thy beauty, for he is thy Lord, and worship thou him. He is thy Lord. You see, then it's talking about the bride of Christ, and we are influencing that bride. We are making that bride to say, I yield my all, I surrender my all, I give everything completely unto this King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and nothing will ever hinder us from total association and total affiliation and total attachment unto this King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Revelation chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 7, it says, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. What's the purpose of the church, and what's the purpose why we're preaching? So that the wife will know, what will I do to please my bridegroom? What will I do to be beautiful before the bridegroom? What will I do that will make the bridegroom, Jesus Christ, to so love me, to so appreciate me, to be proud of me, and to present me before the angels and before generations of all men? What will I do? That's why it says the wife has made herself ready. The wife is not thinking, you know, this is what I want for myself, for my own kind of what I like. No, it's thinking about the bridegroom, and it's thinking about the Christ, and it's making herself ready by saying, I know this is what Christ wants. I know that's what my bridegroom wants. I know that's what my husband wants. I know that's what the Lord, that's what he wants. And in knowing that this is what he wants, and we are the people to be revealing to the church that this is what he wants. And because of that, they're preparing themselves, and they're cleansing themselves, and they're submitting themselves, and they're surrendering themselves. All the programs were made. All they will say during the retreat, or having this and that program, all the messages were put there. It is to make the bride conscious that the bride should prepare herself to be beautiful before the bridegroom. Look at verse 8. It says, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. We'll be ready in Jesus' name. And then we'll prepare the bride of Christ, the people of God, to be ready in Jesus' name. Point number 2 now, definite plan for the building of the church. Definite plan to be for the building of the church. If we're going to build, of course, you need a plan. You need to sketch something down. That's why the architects, that's why those draftsmen, that's why we have all the construction workers, so that they'll be able to look at the plan. They'll be able to look at the pattern, that this is what to be built. There must be a definite plan for the building of that church. When we say building, you can build a family, you can build a home, you can build a life, you can build a man, you can build a woman up, you can build a child up. You're building them to feed the purpose of God in creating them. You look at a child and say, I see in this child the possibility of being such and such in the future. And then you put your everything you've got, your resources, your knowledge, you put into that child in building that child up. You see an orphan, and then that orphan, you take that orphan, has no father, has no mother, but he has life, and he's still here on earth. And then you say, this orphan, I see something like what Mordecai saw in Esther. Father was gone, mother was gone, and said, I see something in this young girl. And then built up that girl, eventually became a savior in cause for the people of Israel. You know the story. That's the reason why we're here, so that we understand there's a building of the body of Christ, and there's a building of the church, and we have a plan for that, a definite plan. I'm coming back again to this Matthew chapter 16, and we're reading from verse 18. Matthew 16 verse 18, and I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. And Jesus must have, of course, he knew that if we're going to build, there must be a definite plan, there must be a definite provision, there must be the cost. We're willing to pay the price. That's why it says in Luke chapter 14, in building, Luke chapter 14, we're looking at it from verse 28, for which of you intending to build a tower, eternity to build a family, eternity to build a profession, eternity to build a man, eternity to build a woman, eternity to build a church. Which of you, eternity to build a tower, seateth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? You know, there are people, they just go into something and they do not understand that if you're going to build a home, it takes some real effort, it takes some real provision, it takes some real decision, it takes some real determination that I'm going to build a home. How do you build a home without any plan? How do you build a home without any pattern and without any model? How do you build a home without sitting down saying, this is the kind of home I'm going to build? How do you pick up a child, you pick up a student and say, I'm going to build up this student. What syllabus do you have? What subject are you going to teach? And what are you preparing the child for? What in your own imagination? What in your own mind? Do you think that in 10 years time, this is where I want to see this child, and this is where this child will be? It is when you have that goal and that destination, that destiny, and you have that model before you, that you're saying, this is to build. So everything you do with that child, with that student, every day, every week, every term, every semester, every session, it is going to depend on the vision that you have. The same thing when you're building a home, when you're building a church, when you're building the assembly of the people of God, you have that in front of you, that this is what I'm doing to build this church. And then it says, you will sit down first, you will count the cost, and you'll say, if this is the home I'm going to build, if this is the family I'm going to build, if this is the church I'm going to build, I need to count the cost. Let's apply to ourselves over here. The Lord, I told you, he showed me that revelation. And he showed me that this is the kind of church it was, deeper Christian life ministry to be, and later deeper life Bible church to be. I must sit down. I must ask myself, if that is the kind of bride that he wants me to prepare, he wants us to prepare together, am I willing to pay the price? What will it cost? Can somebody do this with self-indulgence, our self-pity, our self-satisfaction, our self-aggrandizement, that all he wants is just to enjoy life and to sleep quite a lot and to eat a lot and to, you know, travel here and there just for sightseeing? Can somebody build a church on the basis of just looking for ease in life? Or if that is the kind of church he wants us to build, if this is the kind of a body of Christ he wants us to present to him on that final day, what is the cost? It will cost this. And if you're willing, then you say, Lord, I'm willing. It will cost you this and cost you this and cost you this. It is not going to be cheap, because building a church is the highest body, is the highest assembly of people you can find in the whole of the world. That's why it says, Jesus said that you sit on your couch, the cost. And in verse 29, less happy after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold will begin to mock him. It's like, you know, somebody said, I'm going for education. You say, at this age, you're already at this age, and you're going for, yes, I want to have this degree, I must have it. And then they say that it doesn't matter, age doesn't matter. So and so did it, so and so did it, so and so did it. I'm going to do it. All right, go and do it. And then he attends the classes for the first semester or first term, and then he says, huh, I don't think I can face this again. This is so I compete with all these other young people and reasoning with them, doing tests with them. I don't think I can do this. And then we'll see him, you know, the semester, the session is still on. And then we'll see a, you know, old man, and we'll say, ah, but you said we are going to school. He said, I tried that thing, I cannot make it. And then we begin to talk to our neighbor. See, we told him that you couldn't make it and you didn't make it. You will make it in Jesus' name. And you know, people that could go into, they go into a particular project or something, and then they say, will say, can you do this? Are you ready for this? Can you pay the price to get it? Of course I can. And then they try it in. They just say, this thing is harder than I thought. And then they withdraw. They're not able to do it. And then you want to become a pastor. A pastor in Deeper Life Bible Church, preparing the bride of Christ and preparing the people who are holy and set and pure and righteous through and through. And then we'll say, you want to be a pastor? Of course. course I want to do it. And you're excited for the moment. You want to be a missionary. Can you do this? Of course I can. After 3 months, then you backpedal. You say, I thought it was easier than this. I don't think I can make it. And then the devil begins to make fun of him. And the evil spirit begins to make fun of him. And his dreams, all the fun will be coming. And then you thought you'll do it. Look at yourself. You're a failure. You'll not be a failure in Jesus' name. We count the cost. We count the cost that we're building. There's a definite plan. What God wants the church to be and where he wants to take the church to, and you want to be part of the people that have counted the cost, and you say, I will do it, and you will do it in Jesus' name. In verse 30, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. This man began to build and was not able to finish. You have started, you will finish. I said you have started, you will finish. But you must lay it on a strong foundation. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm reading there from verse 9. In verse 9 it says, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. You see that it says the church is a building. They're not a physical building. It's building us. Building us on the foundation of Christ according to the grace of God which is given unto me as a wise master builder. Now you understand what took Paul the apostle. You know the persecution? You know the ridicule? You know the self-denial? And you know all the gifts and all the graces that he needed, and that he actually built the church? And he says, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builders thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man builds upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest. And for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try and test every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he has built thereupon. If any man's work abide, which he has built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. That means that you see many people are building, but they don't understand, and they don't think about the materials they're using to build, and they do not remember the kind of building they are having. You know, anybody can build. Some people build with wood and hay and stubble, and then they have all that shed, and people can still stay under that and sleep. And you can still prevent rain from, you know, falling on them. You can still prevent the sun from shining on them there. And then you can still, of course, that out. But when the fire erupts and then burns down that kind of shine, then you understand what you are built. There are other people who are building with precious stone and silver and gold. And when the fire will come to test that building, that apartment, it will stand. That's what the Lord is telling us there. He's saying that although we're building, there must be a pattern. There must be something there, an enduring house, an enduring edifice, an enduring building that we're presenting before the Lord. And if he says when the fire comes, if he guts that house, and then all that is burned, and there'll be no reward, then you'll be saying, so as by fire. But if everything will stand, and by the grace of God, our work will stand. I said our work will stand. When the testing comes, the persecution comes, and then the people are still standing on the watch of the Lord, and they still say they didn't give up Christ. They didn't say, I didn't know this how it will be. Some other places where they are building, once they have some reverses in life, and then there's no money, they say, well, if that is Christ, the Christ you are telling us will make us rich and prosperous, and then where's the pursuit? They backslide. Other people, you know, when they have little sickness, they will say, well, you say that Jesus is a healer, and I'm still having the sickness, and therefore, what am I doing? The Christ, and then they backslide. But we are here, we know Christ heals, we know he prospers, and we know he blesses people. But when temporarily there's some reverses, and this has happened and that has happened, we say, yes, I still know that my Redeemer liveth, and even though the skin worms will eat this flesh, I know I shall see him face to face. If we're building people like that will stand, they will stand the test of time. when the test of fire will come upon that building we're raising up, it will stand in Jesus' name. And great will be your reward. You will not lose your reward in Jesus' name. Point number three now is the declared prayer for the body of Christ. The declared prayer for the body of Christ. To make this church and to make the body of Christ and the bridegroom, what the bride, what it ought to be, the Lord himself is praying for that church. And our prayer shall match the prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ for the church. He knows how to pray for his own bride. You ask a husband, what prayer request do you have for your wife? And he knows the best prayer request he ought to have for his wife. And nobody knows how to pray for that woman like the husband. The same thing, Christ knows the kind of prayer request he must raise to the Father on behalf of the bride. And nobody knows how to pray for that bride, for the church, like the Lord Jesus Christ. And there is the prayer he prayed in John chapter 17. I'm reading verse 9. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. They belong to the Lord. They were born again. They were saved. And they were totally given up. They were the bride of Christ. Now in verse 14 it says, I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them. That's a prayer. That's a prayer. He was praying for his own bride. They're still in the world, but I don't want any mess, any defilement of the devil to come on them, any defilement of the world to come upon them, any defilement of Satan or evil spirit to come upon them. Keep them from the evil. He'll keep us in Jesus' name. And then he says, they are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. That's the prayer he prayed for the church. And that is still the prayer every minister must be praying for his own church. Every minister must pray for the local church. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And when he prayed like that, he also said in verse 21, that they all may be one. That they all may be one. And you never contradict your prayer if you are praying sincerely. If you are praying, look at Jesus Christ. He didn't knock the heads of his own disciples together. He wasn't talking to Peter and saying, be careful of that John. And he wasn't talking to James, be careful of Peter. He wasn't talking to Matthew, be careful about Lumiel. No, because he prayed for their unity. He must work for their unity. He must preach for their unity. He must promote their unity, because that's what he was praying for. And if God is telling you that you're a pastor in the church, you're a leader in the church, and your prayer will match the prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ, that they all may be one, then you are going to work for the unity of that church. You're going to preach for the unity of that church. You're going to provide for the unity of that church. You're going to sacrifice for the unity of that church. Verse 21, that they all may be one, as our Father art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. He wants the whole world to believe that the Father has sent him. And because of that, he prayed for their unity. And you want to look at the prayers in the Bible, in the New Testament, how the apostles prayed for the church. Then you want to bring all those prayer requests out. You want to be praying for the church like that. That this is what you want for the bride of Christ, for the body of Christ, for the building where Christ himself dwells. And it says in verse 22, and the glory which thou givest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, and that which thou hast given me, for thou loved me before the foundation of the world. That's a prayer you pray for the church. And when you are a real minister, a real child of God, you are passionate about it. You are fervent about it. Pray for the church. Colossians chapter 4. Colossians chapter 4, I'm reading there in verse 12. Colossians chapter 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluted you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers. Always laboring fervently for you in prayers. If you want really the church to be the real bride of Christ, holy and chaste and pure and righteous and sanctified, you're praying for the church. You're building the church, you're preaching to the church, you're encouraging the church, you're motivating the church, you're counseling the church, you're doing everything you can do for the church. You're also praying for the church, fervently praying always for you, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. That's a prayer. We pray for the church, that he may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. So we're not saying, well, we can manage you the way we are. Although we're not the best, we ought to be able to. We're trying. We're doing our best. Although we're not perfect, but we're better than many other assemblies. No, we want to pray for the church, that the church will be a real bride. What if, you have a bride, and the bride says, well, Lord, I know I'm not all right, totally complete, but at least I'm manageable. You don't want a manageable wife, do you? I said to you, what do you think, that Christ was a manageable church, a manageable wife? That although the church is not what it ought to be, but we can manage. Well, no, we cannot manage. He wants the church to be pure and to be holy and to be chaste and to be sanctified and to be righteous. And the church is going to be like that in Jesus' name. As I conclude, I want to remind you of this verse 17 here. What the Lord is calling you to. He has called you to raise up a bride and to raise up a people that will glorify the name of the Lord. And he says, and say to Archippus, put your name there. And say to Archippus, I said, put your name there. Now read that out loud. And say to, tell me out loud. And say to, I say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord. The Lord has called you to the ministry. Any position where you are now, brothers and sisters, God might have used me or used any of our overseers, any used any of our people to help you to get there. But really, really, it is the Lord who has put you there. And you want to honor the Lord and praise the Lord and say, oh Lord, see what you've done for me. You put me here, and now the Lord says, we should say to you, when Paul the Apostle wrote to Colossian believers, what it means is, all the members of the Colossian church, every one of them, every time they met Archippus, they'll say, this is what we're telling you. That means, if they had 100 members, all those 100 members, Paul the Apostle said, all of you, 100 people, go tell him, take heed unto yourself, and to the ministry which you have received of the Lord, that thou fulfill it. And that means then everybody around you, every brother around you, every sister around you, calling upon you and talking to you and looking at you eyeball to eyeball and saying that God has placed you here for a purpose. God has brought you in here to fulfill this ministry and to do this. This is what he has called you to. And say to, then he mentions your name, take heed to the ministry, to the calling, to the assignment, to the responsibility, to duty that Christ has brought you to, that thou fulfill it. You're going to fulfill it in Jesus' name. Why don't you rise up and tell the Lord, I will fulfill the ministry that he has given to me. This revelation of God for the purpose of God for the church, that the church will be a bride of Christ. The church will be a bride of Christ. The bride of Christ. And you are part of that bride. It was so chaste, it was so holy, it was so sanctified, it was so righteous, it was so pure. It wants you to be without blemish, holy through and through, holy within and holy without, transparently holy and permanently holy, holy every time, every moment, all the days of your life, holy in the secret and holy in the public, holy, holy every time. That's what he calls the church for. And everything you do, every prayer you pray, every preaching you give, every ministry you give, you are trying to help the church to be that chaste, to be that righteous, to be that pure, to be that holy, and to be that sanctified. That's the purpose, the divine purpose of Christ for the bride. That's why he sent you as a minister. Open your mouth and tell the Lord, I will do it. Lord, I will do it. Lord, I will do it. Lord, I will not fail. I will not fail you. I will not fail you. I'm going to do my best to make sure that the bride of Christ is what the bride of Christ ought to be. Forget your father's house. If you're going to be beautiful in sight of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, influence the church, inspire the church, instruct the church,
help the church, teach the church, lead the church.
To understand the calling God has given to the church. To love Christ, the bridegroom. To love Christ, the bridegroom. Totally devoted to Christ, the bridegroom. Totally submissive to Christ, the bridegroom. Bride of Christ. Bride of Christ. Every message you give shall be preparing the bride for the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything you minister, anytime, any moment, should be preparing the bride to be a kind of bride that Christ will have joy over, and present that bride joyfully, cheerfully, happily to the Father, to the Holy Spirit, before the angels, before the generations of people that have lived, to say, this is my bride, and be happy over that bride. Influence the bride, instruct the bride to be holy, righteous, pure, chaste, submissive, noble, honorable. Build according to pattern. Build according to plan. You don't just build. Look at the picture the Lord has shown, the pattern the Lord has shown for the church. Build according to that pattern. Lay a strong foundation. Strong foundation. Don't build on the sand. Dig deep. The foundation of repentance from dead works, from sin, foundation of faith in Christ, foundation of real conversion, foundation of real salvation, a foundation of total commitment and surrender, yieldedness to the Lord Jesus. Lay that foundation. Don't just tell people, come, they come to the church, but there's no foundation. Build according to the plan. Build according to the pattern. The foundation of righteousness. The foundation of holy living. Don't just raise up a shouting assembly, an excited assembly, enthusiastic assembly. They don't know what they're enthusiastic about, what they're excited about. They're on. Who are they running from? Who are they running to? They don't know. Active. But activity is superficial. Let there be a plan, a pattern, a model, a destination, a destiny. And you build every convert towards that destiny. Build the youths towards that destiny. Build the families, the homes, towards that destiny. Preaching must have a purpose. Must have a goal. Must have a direction. Your preaching, your ministry, must have something you want to achieve. every message. Every teaching, every moment of ministration shall be adding something to that building, building according to plan, according to pattern. And the prayers we pray for the church should match and agree for the prayer Jesus prayed for his church. That the church is not of the world, as he was not of the world. But our preaching and praying should sever and separate the church from the world. Our prayers unite the church, not divide the church. Our ministry and ministration should unite the church, not divide the church. Our exhortation, our influence should unite the bride with her bridegroom. Our influence to make the bride beautiful, not to the world, but to the bridegroom. The Lord is saying to you, take heed to the ministry which you have received of the Lord, that you fulfill it.